Good afternoon, church. Good to see your smiling faces and to be able to gather together on this wintry afternoon in March. Kids are excited about March break coming up next week. I know my grandkids are, so good for them. I'm not sure we're as excited because we're the babysitters during the week, but it'll be good. We love our grandkids. Good to be able to come together and worship the Lord together. We're continuing in a series on looking at the fact that Jesus has close encounters with his people and the close encounters he had when he lived on this earth. So we're going to continue that today. But this afternoon, oops, there it is right here. The sheet wasn't with me. There's a couple of announcements I want to bring to your attention. People have been phoning and asking with the changes that are happening in the loosening up of restrictions for COVID, what is happening here at the church. So I want to give you some foretaste or some time to hear this. March 21st, officially the wearing of masks will become optional. And so I want you to know that if you come to church and don't wear the mask, you're welcome. If you come to church and you wear a mask and you leave it on the whole time, you're welcome. You're all welcome, no matter what the situation. You're all welcome now, no matter what the situation. But from the government's point of view, March 21st is going to be the first time. Our next deacons meeting is Wednesday, March 23rd at 1 p.m. here at the church. Anyone who wants to come to the meeting is welcome to come. We have no secrets behind closed doors. We are going to discuss a number of things towards going ahead with the loosening of the restrictions. So we're going to discuss whether or not we're going to continue with a Friday service, the way we set up for church on Sundays. We're going to discuss Sunday school in the future, what that might look like. So there's a number of things we're going to discuss at that meeting. Anyone interested is welcome to come. Our call to worship today is found in Psalm 116, verse 1 to 7. It says this, I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came upon me. I was overcome by trouble and by sorrow. And yet, then when I called on the name of the Lord, you, O Lord, you saved me. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord protects the simple-hearted. When I was in great need, he saved me. Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has indeed been good to you. Amen to that. He's been good to us. Good Lord, good God. Let's come and talk to him together in prayer. Father God, it is sweet to hear your word proclaimed. It is sweet to be reminded by your word that you are a good God, that you are the God who saves, and that when we were at our worst, you still loved us. And for many of us, when we were at that state, that's when you called our name. That's when you called to us to come to you. And so we come into your presence this afternoon with praise on our lips, with thanksgiving in our hearts, wanting to praise you, wanting to sing praises unto you, wanting to hear your glorious word read and preached, because we know you through your word and by your spirit. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you live within us. It is you who calms our hearts when sometimes we get full of fear, when anxiety raises its ugly head. It is you that calms our heart. So we thank you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you that you are the one who gives us wisdom through your word. Guide us. Help us as the body of Christ, not just here at West Guilford, but the body of Christ, all those who call upon the name of the living God, of Jesus Christ. Help us to keep our eyes fixed on you, to keep thankful for what you've done, to keep seeking unity and oneness in Christ, because it is only when we are united that your word says the world will see and that they will Your Spirit will speak to their hearts and say, see what I've been doing? Father, make us a good witness. There are times when we haven't been a good witness, but we pray that you will help us. Help us to be the witness that you want us to be. We pray that you may continue to shower your grace upon this needy world that we live in. And Father, we think of things in Europe, Father, in the Ukraine, and Father, between that conflict with the Ukraine and Russia. And lots of times we want to jump in and give our two cents, but only you know the real need there. You know that there are innocent people that are suffering, mothers and grandmothers and children and babies. And so we ask for mercy for the innocent, Father. We ask that you may provide housing and food for those who have been displaced. Their homes have been destroyed. That is a reality that no one can deny. Father God, we pray for compassion for the world towards taking in refugees. Father, we pray that you will bring peace where only you can bring peace, that you will talk and speak to the leaders of both Russia and Ukraine, and that you may help them to see that it is you who wants to rule all things and that we need to look to you. And Father, I don't know enough about the leadership of either country to know if they have any religious background, if they've truly put their faith in Jesus Christ or not. But Father, we pray for mercy there. We thank you that the church is still alive and thriving in places. Many of the buildings have been destroyed, but many are meeting underneath bridges that have been bombed, in subways. They're meeting in abandoned homes. And we thank you for that. We thank you that 80% of the pastors in Ukraine, that's what they estimate, are still in the Ukraine. They're still there trying to shepherd their people. So, Father, be with your people. Be with your people in Russia as well. There are many Christians in Russia. We pray for them, Father. We pray as they are upset with the way things are going and confused, and yet they are praying for their leadership, and pray that, Father, that all may seek after you, may seek your face. Have mercy, Father. Have mercy especially on who you see as the righteous and the innocent. We pray, Father, these things in your name. We also pray for our country. We certainly don't live in a perfect country here in Canada, but we have so much to be thankful for. So thank you for our homes. Thank you for the fact that they are warm. Thank you, Father, for food, even though the prices of the food are going out the ceiling. We have food. Most of us can still afford food. Thank you, Father. We pray for our country, Father, for those who lead it, our Prime Minister, and we pray for our Premier, for those who give them information, those in charge of the health mandates and the loosening of those mandates. We pray that you will help us all to inch forward. Some may think it's too fast, some may think it's too slow. Only you know for sure. Help us, Father, to not point fingers at those who think differently from us, to love and accept one another in whatever situation we find ourselves in that scale. We pray, Father, for pure motives for our country's leaders. We pray for those who've been on the front line so very long. Doctors and nurses and PSWs and, Father, those who have tried their very best to stay neutral and just serve. Help us, Father, to have servant hearts, to ask you, what can we do? How can we help others, Father? Pray especially for the poor in our country, those who are finding it hard to get by. Every little rise in fuel or in food takes away part of their quality of life. And Father, we pray that you will help them, Father, through this, that you will help us as churches to not only hear about, but to be able to do something, even a little bit, to help those who are finding they're having such a hard time. We thank you, Father, in this church that ones like Ruth Casey, who were in the hospital, who had her hip surgery, she's now at home and praising you at home. She isn't going to be able to go out for a while, but her spirits are up, and she's so glad to just be back into her own home. So continue to be with her and encourage her. We pray for Marcia Bull, Father, for Marcia Bell, who begins her 5 days of radiation this Monday. And Father, we pray for her along with her mom and dad, Gary and Kathy, that you may use this radiation to help shrink the two spots that are in her body, bring healing to her, Father, renew her spirit, that she gave her heart to you when she was young, Father. May that Holy Spirit that lives within her now be renewed, and may it come to fruition in a very powerful way. That's what they're praying for, Father. So we pray along with them. We continue to pray for Dan Kenny, a Christian brother from another church who continues with his 6 weeks of radiation treatment. Week three, I think he's going into. Father, continue to help him and his wife and his children. Be their strength, Lord. Help them to keep their eyes on you. And we think of those that we know. I know of a handful who have had strokes in the last year and a half, 2 years. Darko Knezovic from this church, who has come along very well, but we're continuing to pray for complete healing for him. Pray for Murray Misko and Jody Langman and others who are recovering from strokes, Father. We pray that you may just continue to encourage them in their bodies, but in their spirits especially. We also pray for your continued grace, Father, for those in the community who have found this winter so very long and hard, for those who have been depressed and lonely, those who have not seen hardly anyone, and some have just kind of stopped even trying to reach out to people. May you help us to continue to reach out to ones we know who perhaps no one else reaches out to them, but we can, Father. We pray that in your time you will start to loosen people's hearts who have not worshiped in their churches for maybe 2 years, that you will put it on their heart, Holy Spirit, to come and see, to come and be part of again with the body of Christ in person. We understand the fears and the reasons why many have not been together with the rest of the body, but things are opening up, and we pray that you will loosen up the hearts that you want to come back, return, and be with the body. So we thank you, Lord. We thank you that you hear our prayers at all times, that you are a merciful, compassionate God, and that you have shown mercy on us. And we pray all these things in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're going to worship the Lord together through song. I'm going to leave that there.
Oh, You're my all. You're
We're continuing that series that I talked about, Close Encounters with Jesus. Imagine to have had a personal encounter with him face to face. We talk about having a personal relationship with Christ, and yes, we certainly do when we have put our trust in him, when we have bent our knee and given him control of our lives. And there are some times that close encounter with him seems like heaven or a slice of heaven. I know when my dad was in the hospital just before he died, I went to visit him, and after a while he said, "I'm too tired. I need to sleep." I said, "Okay, Dad, I'm going to go to the chapel." And I went down to the chapel, probably this size, and down in the chapel, nobody else there. I just closed my eyes and started worshiping the Lord. One song after another came, and I don't know how long I sang, but it seemed like it was a long time. Tears coming down my eyes. And it was such a wonderful time with the Lord, just being in his presence together. And the good news is we can do that anytime, right? We can do that any place. Don't have to be in this sanctuary. We can be in God's bigger sanctuary outside, more comfortable for most in the summer, but wherever he leads us. You know, most of us, many of us have a special place at home where we draw into his presence. I love that. Early in the morning, before the phone starts to ring, before any of that stuff. On a good day, I'll leave my phone upstairs, so even if it rings, let it ring upstairs. And let me begin my day with the Lord. Well, today I want to talk about what I've called a close encounter with a wee little man. So most of you know right away that we're going to be looking at that wee little man and his encounter with Jesus. And his name was Zacchaeus. And we know he wasn't very tall from Scripture. We're going to read that Scripture in a minute, but also from that song, which our one family of kids are going to sing for us on Sunday. Zacchaeus was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. So on Sunday, those who are here will be blessed hearing that. How wee was this wee little man? Well, curiosity got me to look and see which country has the weest, meaning the tallest wee little men. And not surprisingly, it's North America, that the average height of a man in North America is 5'9". That's the average. So wee, I guess, is under 5'9". So then I had to look and see, well, what country has the shortest average? And a country that I forgot was a country, Timorese. You ever hear of that country? Never heard of that country at all. The average is 5 feet tall. So if you're 5 feet tall, then Timorese, your average size. So I guess some of us, a few men that are here, we're big guys, we'd be giants over in Timorese. This afternoon, though, I want us to look and see how Zacchaeus and his encounter with Jesus changed his life. And truly, it had very little to do with his height, but a little bit. We're going to look at that. But we're going to look at how his life was changed by this wonderful encounter with Jesus. So we're going to turn to Luke 19, if you want to turn or if you want to just listen. Luke 19, and we're going to look at the story of Zacchaeus. Wee little man, it says, who wanted to see Jesus. Zacchaeus. Says this, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man who was there by the name of Zacchaeus heard that he was coming through. He was a chief tax collector and was very wealthy. He wanted to see who this Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and he welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be a guest of a sinner? But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, Here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost." That's my favorite part. He came to seek and to save what was lost. I'm going to look at that more in a little while. Like most encounters with Jesus, Zacchaeus met Jesus as Jesus and Zacchaeus were going about their regular business. That's how and when Jesus met most people. He didn't plan meetings. He didn't plan worship times. Most times, his encounter with people came as he was going about his business. In this case, he was going through town. Many times I find that's when I encounter people. That's when I have sometimes the best encounters, is when I go to the post office. I usually make sure I have a good chunk of time to go to the post office, because being here a long time in this county, I often meet someone and I just let the Spirit lead. Sometimes it's a hi, how are you doing? Certainly during the last 2 years, it's been much more of that than longer talks. There are people that I've seen at the post office who had to say, "Pastor Brian, it's me." And I didn't even know, especially in the wintertime. They got a toque on down to here. It's a sunny day, so they have sunglasses on, and they got their mask on. Somehow they know my body type, I guess. But, oh, you didn't even say hi to me. Who are you under there? It's been tough the last couple of years, but still, we need to realize that most encounters that we're going to have with people are not going to be at church on Sunday, and that's been even hard to have meaningful encounters with our brothers and sisters in Christ, with our chairs separated, with the masks on, with not, you know, telling people we'd rather you have most of your fellowship outside, it's better for you, healthier for you, the clean air. It's been tough not having pot blessing meals. It's been tough not having those times where we could encounter each other. But we need to take heart from this. Jesus and Zacchaeus met each other. It was an unplanned encounter, but it was a wonderful encounter. Verse 1 says that he was passing through. Passing through. I like that. Jesus had most of his times with people was passing through. Maybe it was somewhere in the synagogue, but not most. Most were on the roadside. They were in the village courtyards. They were on boats and mountainsides. And sometimes they were at weddings. And even one was at a funeral for one of his best friends. That's where Jesus encountered people and met with people and met their needs. That's good for us to remember. God wants us to encounter people wherever we are. We need to have eyes to see. Jesus was always about the Father's business. So he is always looking for opportunities to do the Father's business, which was to seek and to save the lost. Is that our heart's desire? Before we go and get groceries, do we say, "Lord, give me an encounter with someone. I got to go get gas today." Do we grumble and say, "Oh, price of gas"? Or do we say, "Lord, when we're meeting together, putting gas in, help me to see someone I could say hi to." I just put gas in this week, earlier in the week, and someone from another church, I saw them, and I said, "Hey, how are you doing?" "Oh, it's been really tough. Been a really hard time. And now the price of gas," and could easily get into that. God put it on my heart just to remind him and remind myself, we could live in the Ukraine, right? Could be a whole lot worse. He agreed. We both agreed. I said, "God bless you. Good to see you." Short, sometimes the encounters aren't always long, but when we have an encounter with people, we need to try to pick up their spirits. We need to try to point them to Jesus. Well, Jesus was going through town, and as he was going, passing through, came to Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus heard about him. And that's interesting that he did, because it says that A man was there. He was a chief tax collector and wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was. So it tells us a little bit about who he was as a man. He was a chief tax collector. He wasn't just a tax collector. Matthew was a tax collector. He might have been in charge of Matthew. He was in charge of other tax collectors. That's what made him a chief tax collector. In today's society, we might call him the boss. He was the boss of a whole bunch of other tax collectors. He took in what they had taken in from the people. And it also tells us that he was wealthy. Well, that shouldn't surprise us, because anything we know about tax collectors of that day, some would say of this day too, is they took in more than they should have. They often cheated the people. They skimmed it off the top. And they were not liked for that. They were known for that, but they weren't liked for that. They also worked for the enemy. They worked for the Romans. They were almost always Jewish, but they were employed by the Romans. And they weren't popular for that as well. Zacchaeus was that man, the chief tax collector of his area, and who was wealthy. You know, some of us maybe have been blessed with good jobs. Good when we were working. Many of us in this church are retired, but some of us had good jobs with steady income and with regular vacation time. Maybe it didn't make us rich from our country's point of view, but compared to the world, most of us are pretty well off. He was pretty well off, and he took it for granted. Most tax collectors did. They were wealthy. It went to their head. They wanted more and more, and yet most of the ones depicted in Scripture were not happy. Matthew wasn't a happy man before he came to Christ. And it tells us here that Zacchaeus desperately wanted to see Jesus. If he had everything he wanted, if he had peace of heart, why was he so desperate to see this Jesus? And yet he was. And Scripture tells us that his desperation caused him to run ahead because there were so many people around, he couldn't see. He was a wee little man. The crowd was large and he was small, and so he wanted to get to a place where he could see. So he ran ahead, maybe looking for a building he could stand on, he could climb up on. But he found a tree, a sycamore tree. And we're going to show you a picture of one, because I'd never seen a sycamore tree before, but Betty found us one. See the tree? No, you see? That's a man at the base of the tree. It's a big tree. When I think of a sycamore fig tree, I always thought of a little tree where you could just pick the figs, right? But look at the size of that tree. That is a big tree. And it says that he found the tree and he climbed up in the tree. Doesn't tell us any more. Did he hide in the tree? Did he not want to be seen by other people? We're not sure. We could presume that maybe he didn't. It wasn't very dignified for a rich person, never mind a tax collector, to run in that day. Maybe you've heard of that. They wore long, almost dress-like gowns, and they had to roll them up above their knees to run. So they looked funny running, and it was hard to run. It certainly wasn't dignified for someone who had a position of wealth and honor. And so to run was very unusual. But then to climb a tree, tree climbing was like today, it's for kids. Kids climb trees. My grandkids love climbing trees. I don't climb trees anymore. I look in this small group of people, I don't think any of you climb trees anymore. Maybe one says, I do. Yeah, I can see it, Val. I can see you doing that. He had some obstacles that he had to overcome. He had to overcome the fact that he was small, the crowd was large, he needed to get to a place where he could see, and we have some obstacles sometimes. I have people say, oh, you know, I pursue God more, but, you know, I don't read very well, so I can't read the Bible. You can listen to it. You can watch it. There's all kinds of apps, all kinds of TV shows you can watch, YouTube things. Well, I don't read very good. Or I work on Sundays. In this day and age, that's no excuse. I mean, you can draw close to the Lord in your home through an app, or you can, hear and talk to other people. You can go to Bible studies. We have a men's group that meets on Wednesdays, women's group that meets Wednesdays as well. There's no excuse time-wise. It's not the right time. There probably will never be the right time. Some physical obstacles are in the way of people. People who are lame, people who can't get out, don't have a vehicle. I tell people at this church, if you want a ride and don't have a ride, let us know. We will get you a ride. There has not been one person in this church in 10 years or in the 22 years I spent at Lakeside who I couldn't get a ride from. Not, I'm a great ride provider. God's people, if they hear that somebody wants to come and they live relatively close, they will go and pick them up. Dozens of people have been picked up. It's an obstacle, but it shouldn't keep us from being in the presence of the Lord. Everyone has to overcome obstacles. We all have obstacles. Some are lonely. Some have lost loved ones, and they find it hard to go on. I know that feeling. There are obstacles, but they should not be roadblocks. We can continue on with the Lord's help. Matter of fact, oftentimes it humbles us and makes us draw closer to the Lord because of the obstacles. Zacchaeus did two things that most wealthy chief tax collectors would never do. He ran, and he ran ahead, and he climbed up that tree. We need to do whatever it takes to draw close to the Lord. It's our responsibility. I may be your pastor. I may have been your pastor a long time, but I can't make you draw close to the Lord. I can't do the work that we each need to do. We need to seek the Lord with all our might, with all our strengths, while he can be found. We need to seek after him. That's our responsibility. Yeah, but it's been so hard with COVID. Tell me about it. I've said before, I'm saying again, the hardest 2 years of my ministry have been these last two. I'm a people person. If some of you are on Facebook, you might have seen me holding a little baby this week. Big smile on my face. Boy, did you ever have a smile on your... You know, the last time I held a little baby that size was 2 years ago outside of my own family. 2 years ago, and I wasn't expecting it. When I went to visit the family, beautiful. Finally, they said, would you like to hold the baby? Oh, I'd love to hold the baby. I'd love to hold the baby. I love to give hugs to people. I love to lay hands on people and pray with them. You know, I have hardly done that at all. I've done more elbows with people in the last 2 weeks. Once this is all over, I never want to do another elbow. There's nothing affectionate about an elbow. There is nothing consoling. Oh, you know, I can tell you're hurting there. Do you like that? Getting an elbow there. I've broken the rules. I've hugged people, held people, because they were hurting so bad. At funerals, almost every funeral I've done in the last 2 years, somebody has said, I know that I'm not supposed to, but could you give me a hug? Looking around for the funeral director, and they never say anything. One of them attends our church who works it. He says, oh, I've seen a lot of hugs given, but I just kind of turn the other way. You got to be human. You got to be human first. And so as human beings, we need to seek after the Lord. We need to do things, even if they're not considered dignified. Matter of fact, I don't really want to be known as a dignified person. I want to be known as a passionate follower of Christ. And if I'm not dignified at times, so I'm not dignified. David wasn't too dignified when he danced in his underwear. You know, look that story up. Wasn't very dignified. Don't worry about your reputation. Do the right thing. Zacchaeus, he was literally up a tree when Jesus stopped. And he looked up and he said his name, Zacchaeus, come down. I'm going to your house tonight. I'm going to spend the evening with you. The presumption is he was going to spend the night there. Jesus needed a place to stay. He was going to his house. He wasn't taking advantage of him. He had a bigger picture. And Zacchaeus, he was so upset. Well, I'm not prepared. I didn't clean my house. I didn't cook anything. Are you? No, it doesn't say that, does it? When Jesus spoke to him, he was so touched by it. Listen to what he says. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said to him, Jesus said, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and he welcomed him gladly. He welcomed him gladly. Can you picture it? He said, Jesus, you're coming to my house? Come on, it's just two blocks from here. Can I walk with you? Oh, that's great. It'd probably be a little messy, but you're welcome. And all your disciples too, they're all welcome. He was a wealthy man. He probably had a bigger than average house. Invited, probably had some servants. Go get everything you can. Cook it up right now. We're going to have a feast. Jesus wants to come to my house. Do we have that excitement about being with him, having Jesus as part of our life from a purely physical point of view? Do we have that excitement about offering hospitality to other people? There's a man who goes to another church in Haliburton who about 2 months ago, I saw him in town. I don't know what I was doing in town, but he said, Pastor Brian, it's so good to see you. I haven't seen you from the beginning of this pandemic. And I said, it's good to see you too. And they had just opened up the places where you could go in, and that there's a little place, a coffee shop on the main street where the used to be a hardware store. And he said, will you come in and have a coffee with me? Well, it was my day off. I remember that. And I was doing errands, but the look in his eyes was, couldn't see his face, was, I really would like to spend some. I said, sure, let's go in. We went in, and boy, I hadn't been in there before. The coffee is great, but it's expensive. But he said, hey, don't worry about it. I'm paying. And have one of their goodies. They make fresh goodies. So we had a fresh goodie, and we had a coffee, and we had a great chat for 2 hours. 2 hours. I did not plan to spend 2 hours, but it was just great. And he wanted to talk about these people and that people, and we attended the same church at what time? At one time, did you hear about this person? And he just was dying for fellowship. There's a lot of people around us who really would love to have some fellowship. Now that things are opening up, maybe we need to ask the Lord, what would you like me to do that way? How can I? Maybe it's phoning someone up and going to Tim Hortons with them and having some fellowship. You being hospitable, you pay for the Tim Hortons. It's not that expensive. Most of us can save our pennies for that. Maybe it's having people back to your home. I know people do that, used to do that. One time people would prepare some sort of a meal for every Sunday and then see who God led them to and they'd come back. Those days are probably gone. Every Sunday? I think so. But occasionally? What about once a month? We had a person here, Nancy Brink, who went to this church. Some of you know, remember Nancy? She wasn't a rich person. She didn't have a huge house. Nice little cottage-type house on the lake. But she would probably every second week have people come back for sandwiches and soup. She made the soup, and she made the sandwiches. And every person who was invited there, and was many people over the years, oh, it was so nice just to be invited into someone's home. When we have people, it's almost always sandwiches and soup. Diane comes to church with me. She's retired, but only so much energy, only so much finances. Nobody ever says, oh, soup and sandwiches. I thought it would be roast beef. The roast beef days are gone for most of us. But sandwiches and soup, we can do that. Maybe we need to pray. I think we do, and say, Lord, as things open up, help us to be hospitable to one another. One of the things the deacons and I are going to discuss is, do we go back to having monthly pot blessing meals? More than any other single thing, people say, I can't wait to get back to that. I sure enjoyed that. one, for some people, it was the best meal they had of the month, right? Everybody brings something that they, and so you have a nice meal for some people. But I think for most people, it was for just being able to rub shoulders. You can't sit with everyone, but you can sit with some and you can greet others. And are we there yet? Probably not, but I'm looking forward to that. Many people are. Zacchaeus, even though Jesus invited himself for dinner and to stay over, he was so happy. He welcomed him gladly. I think we need to say, Lord, help us have a Zacchaeus-type attitude to make sure that we welcome Jesus, but that we welcome Jesus' children, his family, and maybe some who aren't in his family, or maybe we're not sure they're in our family. Diane and I, when we first got married, we went to a charismatic Catholic church. And so she went to her church, which was a AGC church. I went to mine before, and then we decided we were going to together go on Sunday morning to this charismatic Catholic church. So the first time Diane was with me, I'd been going sometimes to her church. First time she was with me, this couple, Ed and Pauline, came over with three little kids in tow. And they said, hi, don't think we've seen you before. Ed, Pauline, and these are the kids, and the kids all smile at us. Do you have any plans? We're going to have a bit of a brunch after church. We'd love to have you come right before church. We looked at each other. We said, oh, okay, that'd be nice. I had a great time with them. Eggs and bacon, maybe, toast. But it was the kids. We didn't have any kids. We were just married. 2 weeks later, they invited us again. We went to that church for 3 months, and then I was transferred to Peterborough with the company. We probably had brunch at their place 6 times in 3 months. They made us feel so welcomed, so loved, so cared for. We so desperately wanted to connect with another body of Christ when we moved to Peterborough, and they were a big part of it. Their hospitality, their warmth, their reaching out to us. Just loving us. You can love people through little things. We need to remember that. So Zacchaeus was very glad that Jesus was coming, but not everyone welcomed him gladly or was happy. Right afterwards, it says, all the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. All the people, that means the majority of the people, began to mutter and kind of talk and whisper. See, he's going to Zacchaeus' house. Don't you know who Zacchaeus is? That crook, that son of a gun, that guy who loves the Romans more than he loves his own people. Mutter, mutter, mutter. Oh, may God help us not to be that kind of people. To not mutter about each other, to not grumble about each other, to not talk badly about our brother or sister in Christ because they spend time with this person or that person, or they have a belief about this or that that's different from our belief about this or that. Not the gospel, not the good news, not who Jesus is, the Son of God who came and died and rose from the dead. We believe the same on that. But we believe differently on something else. It's going to come soon. Soon they're going to take you have to wear a mask to church off. It's going to be optional. I've mentioned that. Some are going to feel very strongly, I can't wait to get it off. And others are going to, oh, I'm going to keep wearing it. I don't think it's time yet. I'm very leery about them doing this. I think maybe they've rushed the gun. So you're going to be sitting, the chairs are probably going to be more together, maybe just down the row from someone who feels differently on that issue. What's your responsibility? Love them. Love them with a mask on, love them with a mask off. It doesn't matter. It's the heart that Jesus looks at. He doesn't look at the mask. He doesn't care about that the way we've made it into a big deal. Zacchaeus was a sinner that Jesus came to rescue. That's what it says at the end. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost. He came to seek and save lost sinners, like Zacchaeus, like you, me. He came to save sinners. We're all sinners. I think I said it last week. In heaven, there's only going to be forgiven sinners. The only perfect person is going to be Jesus. Everybody else has been saved by the grace and mercy of God. We once were lost, and now I'm found. Zacchaeus was excited that Jesus wanted to go back to his place. And when he heard, because they were all muttering, that they were upset, the people, he wanted them to see that his heart had been changed. Already his heart was changed. He was seeking, he was curious, he was up in the tree, and then Jesus pointed to him, "I'm coming to your house." Somewhere in between that transaction, his heart changed from stone, from wanting to be rich, for wanting to get things his way, to wanting to know this Jesus and to be forgiven by this Jesus and to change his life because of this Jesus. And he proved it right at the beginning. He stood up and he said to the Lord, in front of everyone, I would presume, "Look, Lord," saying Lord indicated he saw him as the Lord. "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor." That's a big commitment. He was a wealthy man. He's giving half of it to the poor right away. I think that shows some commitment. "And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will give him back what I cheated." No, I didn't say that. "I will pay back four times the amount." That wasn't what the law said. That was beyond the law. That was grace. He realized that if he had cheated people, he had hurt them, and he wanted to make amends, true amends. "I'm going to pay him back four times as much, Lord." His heart was broken because of his sin, and his joy was filled because he knew Jesus had forgiven him. And Jesus said to him, "Today, salvation has come to this house." Today, salvation has come to this man, is what he's saying, to this house. Maybe to his servants too. Maybe his servants heard what he said, and they had been cheated the most. And he went to his servants and he said, "Starting with you, four times as much." They knew him, they would be blown away beyond anyone. Jesus said, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is the son of Abraham. He is part of the group that I came to save." Remember, he came to save his people first, but it was bigger than that, and it was expanded beyond that, because he always planned to include whoever. But the Jewish people are still his people in a special way. And he points it out here. "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save what was lost." We're all lost before we come to know Jesus. We all need to come. It sounds to me that Zacchaeus' words show that he was a repentant, humbled sinner at this point, and that Jesus approved of his new heart. This was Jesus' mission from the beginning of time, was to come to earth to seek and save and restore the lost. That's why he died. That's why he rose from the dead. That should be why we're sitting here, why you're watching. If you're watching and that isn't the reason, you just stumbled upon this and for whatever reason you felt you'd watch it to the end, and your heart is pounding now. It's pounding probably not because you're having a heart attack. It's pounding because God is speaking to you. When I first came to know Christ, the girl who told me about Christ, I was perspiring. I was shaking. I had goosebumps. I thought I was catching the flu. And she said to me, she said, "No, Brian, God's trying to get attention, get your attention." And I started to cry, tears coming down. I had that expensive leather that guys in the 70s thought looked good and made them look cool. Had that on. I didn't care. The people who ran the coffee house, we were in an outside coffee house, came and said, "Oh, could we talk to you?" And I said, "No, get away from me. I want to talk to this girl. This girl who just told me God's trying to get my attention." I didn't know who God was. She could have been talking about any of the gods. I didn't. But in her eyes, I could tell there was something different. When she had told me all about Jesus, how to be saved, I said, how do you know this is true? She said, 2 years ago when I was 16, someone told me about Jesus. And I reached out to him and trusted him, and he changed my life. And I looked at her and I thought, wow, if that's true, if God can change a person's life in a heartbeat, in a moment, I need that change. Zacchaeus was just like that. His heart was changed in an instant. Do you know Jesus today? Have you put your trust in him? Are you living for him? I think most that are watching would say, yeah, I put my trust. I prayed that prayer. I've tried. But you know, there's something missing still. I don't have the peace I should. I have too much anxiety. And ask yourself, how are you doing towards drawing close to him now? Are you willing to run ahead and do whatever he wants you to do? To climb a spiritual tree to get his attention? Are you willing to do something different in your spiritual life? Sadly, I've talked to many people who have said, you know, every morning, right after breakfast, I spend 5 minutes reading the daily bread, and we have a little prayer, my wife and I, my husband and I. We spend that good 10 minutes with the Lord every day. Now, I'm not saying that's wrong, but if it's been that way, the same way for 50 years, maybe you need to change it up a little bit. Maybe you need to get up earlier. Maybe before you need go to bed, maybe you need to put a worship album on and worship the Lord. Oh, no, I don't feel comfortable doing that by myself. It's not about comfort. It's about drawing close to the Lord. We all need to say, Lord, if I'm not close to you, it's not because you've moved. It's because maybe I've become entrenched in my own little world, and I need to do more. I've invited people to come and come to men's Bible study, women's Bible study, come to a prayer time. I've had people tell me for 2 years they're going to come sometime. It's never convenient. It's never on your calendar unless you put it on your calendar. You know, praying with people on the phone. In the last 2 years, I've prayed with so many people on the phone, and I've suggested it to many, and no, I don't feel comfortable praying on the phone. Okay, then pray in person. I don't feel comfortable seeing them in person. Maybe it's about comfort. Maybe you need to get past that comfort zone. Even to say God bless you to someone at the end of the conversation and mean it is better than nothing. We have to make sure we haven't fallen into a comfortable rut. You know, I don't think Zacchaeus ever fell into that after meeting Jesus like this. He knew that he was now a follower of Jesus, and he was going to do whatever it took to make things right and to get close and stay close. We need to do that. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful story about Zacchaeus. The fact that he was short means nothing to me, or I believe to you, but it was an obstacle to be overcome, and he overcame it. And even though some people may have laughed at him for running, for climbing up a tree, he didn't care. He wanted to see Jesus. And when he realized that Jesus saw him and knew him, even when he was up in the branches of a sycamore tree, it touched his heart and changed his life. May we live out that changed life, Lord. And if there's any today who have never put their trust in Jesus and they know it, the starting place is by acknowledging that you need him. You need him as your Lord, as your Savior. You need to ask him to forgive you of your sins. You need to be willing to make amends with those maybe that you've hurt. And he will do the rest. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going to sing one last song together.